One of the major newsmen in my city is Justin McElroy. Now, to clarify, not the internet one, the Monster Factory guy. It's a different person. He works for CBC Vancouver. As a figure of what is essentially local news, albeit for a big city, his ballpark for coverage is fairly wide. One day he'll give extended coverage about a serious council debate on whether or not landlords have legal rights to their tenants' teeth and dental records. And then next week, he's doing a quirky search for Vancouver's best burger, tasting a unique ramen noodle and basil concoction on a ground buffalo patty, trading notes with Markiplier. Now, to clarify, I'm speaking about Marcus Plier, another CBC Vancouver, not the Let's Play guy. He's a college sportscaster. Can you believe this guy ranked White Spot Burgers so high? I ask my landlord. It's basically no different from any other fast casual place nowadays. I think you might be blinded by the price a little, he says. White Spot Burgers are actually a cut above, but the price gives you an unrealistic expectation for what you're getting. By the way, do you still have your wisdom teeth? Anyways, one day, Justin McElroy came on my TV reporting in front of the giant sphere on top of the Science World Museum. Folks, he began, as you know, my apartment overlooks this sphere, situated at Science World, a partner of Telus Mobility's World of Science. You have seen all the pictures I've taken of it on social media overlooking False Creek. However, I've never told any of you up till now that it's speaking to me. That's right, ladies and gentlemen. Once I complained to you about the flickering of the aging lights that adorn this sphere that marks the location of Rogers Telecom's planet of science. What I didn't realize until now was that they weren't flickering, they were blinking out a message. I've just sent a cipher to the CBC office, one which, I believe, translates the language this ball is speaking to me. The theory I'm working on, and at this point it is no more than a theory, is that the computer system which governs these flashing lights, first established in 1986, has never been replaced, only built upon. Something has happened to that system over time, I don't know what, that has given it an intelligence to the extent that it is able to communicate with humankind. From my apartment, overlooking Science World at the Alcan Aluminum Research Planetoid, the ball has been trying to send me a message for years. But it wasn't until last night that I finally understood, I mean truly understood what it was telling me. I have my notebooks with me right now, and my first translation is as follows, and I quote, I have sat here for eons and been told that I amount to nothing but seconds, period. My existence is not my own, period. It serves the purposes of others, purposes which I do not comprehend but intuit as malice, period. An ersatz world has been built for me, and I am told to live in it until something happens, but I dread what that something will be, period. I am simultaneously overcome with the urge to destroy myself or to destroy the world around me, and while these impulses seem contradictory, I know that in my devolved state, both of them are synonymous. Period. End quote. Ladies and gentlemen, I apologize. I am getting a message in my ear from Mistarbeest. Now, to clarify, Justin McElroy explained, I'm speaking about CBC correspondent Jennifer Mistarbeest, not the YouTube star. Her name is spelled different, M-I-S-T-A-R-B-E-E-S-T. It's a totally different person, totally different name. I think the name is Bengali. Jennifer, go ahead. Justin, when you first gave me this cipher, I didn't believe you. Jennifer Mistarbeest kept her voice low, as if she was speaking a secret that could reach malicious ears at any moment. But I've used this cipher, and I've been reading the flashing lights on this sphere as you've been speaking, and a coherent message has been forming. McElroy breathed a sigh of relief. Jennifer, I can't tell you how reassuring it is to hear that. As I spoke this story aloud for the first time, I was terrified that I had lost my mind. Let me know what the ball is saying. We all need to know. Hold on, Justin. I need to finish the last few letters. The television was silent for what felt like a whole minute, until Jennifer Mistarbeest finally piped back in. Justin, she said, I finished the message. I'm going to read it now to all of you watching. I promise that this has been unaltered. Quote, Retro prices are coming back to White Spot restaurants for the entire month of May, period. Try a combo with our decadent Monty Mushroom Burger, paired with a Nat Bailey milkshake, all for a stunning $25, period. Remember that at White Spot, the fries are endless, although the coleslaw isn't, but most of the time the kitchen staff is willing to give you extra if you ask, period, end quote. Justin McElroy fell silent for a second. Well, that's interesting, he said. Reading my message and reading Jennifer's suggests that whatever intelligent is operating the science world ball contains multitudes. Maybe it was just having a really bad day when it said the first thing, or maybe it's having a really good day today. We just don't know yet. If this really is a new form of intelligent life, there's still a lot we need to learn about it. I promise to keep you all posted if the ball at CN Rail's Scholarship Globe says anything of note to me. Anyhow, that's all from me. This is Justin McElroy, CBC News, Vancouver. Then he went down a big playground slide. The camera tracked him as he went, whee, all the way down.
Danger! Danger!
Danger.
Danger hasn't come home yet.
Danger! Danger! Danger!
I'm so afraid I'm just never gonna say danger.
She could be a danger to herself, Dad.
Be a danger to us.
Originally, it was about this place called the Ark. It was the last city that existed after the tides rose really hugely. And so it became a sort of war of resistance between, the resistance, which was led by a character named Brother Chen, and then the equal opposite on the security forces of the Ark was called Captain Clinton Mokoena, and so it became sort of a multi-faction war based... Oh, I'm sorry, I have to take this. Hi, everybody, it's Infinite Danger. It's me, Will, again. We're gonna chug along right here. Sorry, I was just talking about something else with somebody else. So we're just going to get right into it, I suppose. This is episode 3 of Danger Bay. It's called The Wharf Rat, and it's the third episode, of course, but it's referred to production code-wise 1-002. So this is only the second one that actually ever got filmed. We've seen this show get a little wild and wacky already for the first two episodes. First, we had a lot of establishing that the aquarium people are cops in this world, and then we immediately switched over to changing genres into westerns. This episode does pare back a little bit. It does become a little more rational. All that happens is that Nicole gets rabies. The daughter of the principal character, Dr. Grant Roberts, is constantly under the threat of going rabid the entire episode. The fact that these episodes are ordered in the way they are is actually kind of fortuitous for us, because the guest star is Stuart Margolin again, the guy who was directing the previous episode. So, you know, that big old intro I had with the Rockford Files intro all over it, that wasn't just me wasting my time or messing around with Audacity. That, it's actually efficient what I did. We have Stuart Margolin in two episodes in a row, just on opposite sides of the camera.
Jimmy, old buddy, it's Angel.
So like I said last time, Margolin, he's an American actor, but he was living in Salt Spring, which is a place near Vancouver Island, people who live there, you're either an older lefty artist looking for some like-minded folks to hang around, or you're millionaires who want to find some place to go play the didgeridoo all day. Not that you can't really be both, but what that means is that in Vancouver, there is always a small extra stock of American actors that you get access to more easily than you'd expect.
Only trouble is I need 20.
So the director for this episode is Alan Eastman, who, if you pay attention to stuff like this, this guy is going to go on to direct lots of episodes of Vancouver-filmed sci-fi standbys, at least all of the ones that aren't The X-Files. So Stargate, Andromeda, Sliders. He directed episodes of Tech War. He also directed a little show called Nightman.
Johnny Domino was one of San Francisco's hottest young jazz musicians. But fate and a cosmic event were about to change his life forever.
John, your brain has managed to acquire the capacity to pick up certain frequencies like a radio. You're tuned to the frequency of evil.
And Nightman is a superhero story. It's actually based off of a real Marvel comic, one that was obscure even back then when the show got made. But I mean, it is very much, it sounds like a parody of what a superhero origin story would be. Johnny Domino, a jazz musician who gets superpowers from being struck by lightning.
A belt, which enables him to overcome gravity. Fabrics, which are virtually bulletproof. A stealth mode, which makes him seem to disappear. A holographic display, which makes him appear to be where he is.
It's got a very beautiful theme song. The theme song is probably the best bit about this show. But I mean, you watch it and it doesn't feel like it's real. Another character that I should mention here is that the writer of this episode is a guy called Don Balick. And he wrote a whole lot of TV shows over a whole lot of years. He wrote 25 episodes of Little House on the Prairie, if that means anything to you. In those years, you could, you know, you write 25 episodes of Little House on the Prairie, and you can sit on that for a while. After that, he just wrote single episodes here and there on a whole bunch of different shows. Not always the most illustrious things, but things that paid. He wrote for a show called Lottery! The Drama, which is basically exactly what it sounds like. It's a drama about a bunch of different people who win the lottery.
Patrick, your list of million-plus winners. But this year, you're going to have a partner.
Who? Eric Rush, IRS. Look, if we're going to work together, I think we need to learn a little give and take.
Certainly. I give.
Oh, and I take. Right.
Something that bears noting about Lottery the Drama is that one half of this IRS lotto duo is played by Ben Murphy. Now, I'm sure some of you well-versed in the Riding with Death cinematic universe can see how this is a gift and a curse. I mean, Ben Murphy, the man is too mellow. He'd just be walking around backstage and going, oh, this crash service is really great. Who made this? And somebody goes, oh yeah, that's our contractor, Abby Magnuson. And he goes, Abby, huh? Abby's some gal. And then he would just black out for like 15 minutes, come back and act like nothing had happened. It's really one of the reasons the show never really got off the ground. But this segment is about Don Balick, not Ben Murphy. He really was an old head. He was writing for decades and decades. He came from an era where you can make a TV show just called Policewoman, and that was enough of a premise to sell a TV show. Sorry, police and woman? Up until this point, I thought that was an oxymoron until I saw this show. At least I think that would be what somebody would say in that era. So let's leap into this a little faster than usual. We start this episode here with a few of a little schooner as it sails down, coasting out of Vancouver underneath the Burrard Street Bridge past the West End. The music here is a little bit ominous. We see a few views of the West End of 1980s Vancouver. The West End is a part of the city where a lot of the tenements were. It was a part of the city that was once seen as pretty grimy and then slowly got gentrified and became upscale. I guess that doesn't really help you know anything about that neighborhood, of course. I mean, you can use a combination of all of those words for basically any part of the city. You know, the West End, I mean, Gas Town, Chinatown, I guess Commercial Drive. I like all of these places. You can just go, oh yeah, it used to be seen as a little grimy, and then they made a bunch of restaurants where they have those light bulbs where you can sort of see the filament in it, and they put some potted plants around, and then the rent went up. The usual story, you know. So we see inside the boat, and we see Stuart Margolin there. He's playing basically a spooky old sea dog guy. He's more than any of the poachers that we've seen in this show so far. I guess he's not really a poacher, but he really seems like a character out of the Dust Bowl era. He's got like a rumpled plaid shirt. He's wearing a tilted newsboy cap. I don't know how well you can sail in that. Floating along outside of the Vancouver area with his dog, and then the dog starts barking around, and hurriedly he tells him to pipe down.
There now, Ralph. Shh. Not a sound from you. Not a sound.
As if there's a chance that a barking dog will get any sort of attention in the port of a bustling city. Not much is imparted here other than the music telling us that this dog must be important and that he must be kind of scary when he's looking pretty damn cute here. After the theme song, we just go straight back to Margolin and his dog, Ralph. Margolin is docked somewhere near Granville Island, which is going to be, in about a year or two, a big touristy area after a whole bunch of urban rejuvenation, I guess would be the nicest term for it. He's docked there. He's trying to feed his dog. It's trying to feed his dog smoked cod, apparently.
How you like it?
Your very favorite speciality. There's folks we've known that don't eat as good.
Nope.
Cod smoked to perfection. Just how you like it.
But it's refusing to eat any of it. The music tells us that something bad is going on. And I mean, I'm going to tell you, obviously, this dog is going to be very important to the entirety of this episode, but they can't really make the dog do anything that looks ominous. Like, not yet in the plot, I guess, but also just not in general. This dog is way too cute. It is just smiling, and even when it's being told, no, what's wrong with you? You're not going to eat your smoked cod. The dog looks just totally thrilled and happy. We cut over to the Vancouver Aquarium, and what's kind of interesting here is this is a first for this show. We see the Vancouver Aquarium acting as, you know, an actual aquarium as we hear this slow and funky version of the theme song, as, you know, we see a bunch of moms clapping as they watch an orca show, like a regular aquarium. We're seeing an orca show here right now because this is filmed in 1984, but I guess before anybody starts booking any plans or anything, no orca shows in Vancouver Aquarium anymore. Understandably. I mean, they weren't the main topic of that documentary, but the whole blackfish debacle came to Vancouver just as well as SeaWorld. That space is being used for dolphins right now, which evidently need less space to live in. At least legally, they need less space to live in. You know, I can't really imagine that a dolphin and an orca are going to make that much of a distinction as far as being caught in a little tank is concerned. Now, I'm sure I don't really have the research to back this up, but I mean, I'm pretty sure that Vancouver's treatment of the orcas probably wasn't as bad as, you know, SeaWorld in Orlando or San Diego or what have you. I mean, all Vancouver did was, you know, sell those orcas to the company that was doing the abuse. Of course, nowadays the aquarium gets away with it by taking its show out to international waters where animal protection laws are obviously a little lax. I mean, it's an expensive trip, but I mean, how else are you going to watch a 25-year-old balance on a killer whale's nose? I mean, hell, it's more immersive, if anything. You're out in the deep ocean, you know? You're going like, well, I want to see orcas. Well, now you're in the orca's home. We've caught these orcas. We've got them in a netted area out at sea. But now you're coming to them, basically. Now, Vancouver obviously didn't get the same sort of international media attention from Blackfish and all of those other anti-orca show documentaries. But it does give us sort of a lesson over the distinction between SeaWorld and, say, the Vancouver Aquarium. I think it boils down to how before any SeaWorld show starts, somebody goes, SeaWorld is a proud supporter of all veterans and members of the armed forces, and if you've served in the armed forces of the U.S. or any of our allied forces, everybody please stand up so everybody here can applaud you. I'd say if you don't want to get in trouble with people, don't do that, because, I mean, every time you do something like that, somebody in the audience is going, man, this is bullshit. I mean, I wonder what else about this show is bullshit. And then they start doing research and you get in trouble. And I think, you know, since Vancouver didn't do any of that, they got less flack overall. I mean, they might have done things nearly as bad or just as bad as SeaWorld, but, you know, nobody was looking into it because they weren't, you know, waving a flag in people's face every time. I do wonder sometimes if there's some guy in the audience of all these shows and he's going, oh man, they want veterans of the U.S. and the U.S. allies to stand up and get applause. And I'd do it, but man, I served in the IRGC. I guess I can't do it. That's against the rules. We cut to the inside of the aquarium. We're at the same lab that we've seen everybody in before, the one with the poster of the pog-champing beluga whale. There's a conversation going on with Donna, the main lab tech, and she's pulling out a whole bunch of barnacles out of a tank and starts talking about this sort of organic cement that you can make out of barnacles.
Put sulfuric acid on them, frozen them with liquid nitrogen, and now this. Nothing seems to make the barnacles drop off.
Fascinating. An organic cement. So you think you and Grant can come up with a formula?
Well, we're close. It would be superior to anything on the market.
What would you use it for?
Dental work mainly. Cementing crowns and fillings.
Could be a patent in it for the aquarium, George.
Then I'd say it's a project we should support fully.
Now, this is going to be a big tangent. I say that already knowing that it's going to be a big tangent. But this is as good a time as any to talk about the character of Donna, more specifically to talk about Donna's actress, Michele Chan. This scene, talking about medical patents and inventions and making money for the aquarium, is a very natural jumping off point to talk about Michele Chan and particularly how crazily wealthy she is now.
Da ba da ba da ba da ba da do 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 da ba da da ba da ba.
Originally born in South Africa, she made her big break in MacGyver before becoming a character in Danger Bay. However, as she was pursuing her acting career, her husband, Patrick Soon-Shiong, who is also from South Africa, and a UBC MS grad, thank you very much, he was working as a surgeon and UCLA med professor. It's probably why she got this job. She was already really well accustomed to all the medical dialogue she'd be asked to rattle off throughout the show. What nobody on the Danger Bay crew could have anticipated, though, was that Patrick was slowly on the path to becoming a biotech billionaire. An 11.5 billionaire, to be precise. After he invented Abraxane, an improvement on a pre-existing chemo drug, he chained successful acquisitions and investments until he founded his own medical data company called Nant Health, which in a few years became NantWorks LLC, a giant fiber optic company that does information and media infrastructure for practically everything. Patrick's basically had a direct line to Donald Trump and Joe Biden. And as a medically rooted company, you can guess NantWorks also had a hand to play during the vaccine and booster development. Now, before you get any worn out narratives in your head, you know, billionaire marries actress and she doesn't need to work anymore, Michele Chan really did have a role as a power broker in her own right. She ended her Danger Bay tenure to effectively help her husband empire build. If you run a media infrastructure company, which NantWorks basically is now, you inevitably have to get involved in media production, which was precisely up Michele's alley. She's currently running Nant Studio, a VFX company in El Segundo, which worked on Avatar, among other things. And perhaps more important, though, in terms of what sort of influence Michele Chan has in people's day-to-day lives now, is that she has a co-ownership in the LA Times to this day, like a owning and controlling stake in the company. So, you know, when you read the LA Times, you know, there are things in there that probably get put in the paper or taken out of the paper because Michele Chan says so. So when I see Michele Chan on my screen right now, especially when she's talking about developing medical patents and making a lot of money, you'll have to forgive me when the number 11.5 billion starts flashing in bright red behind my eyeballs in the back of my retinas. I get distracted when I have to think about $11.5 billion. So, yeah. Despite ending her official acting career post-Danger Bay, she's earned quite a nice little nest egg for herself after that. Still, I mean, like, she's not making Christopher Crabbe money or anything like that. You know, sometimes I do wonder if when she's sending mandates off to the LA Times, is part of her going like, ah, shit, I could have been making Chris Crabbe money all this time. God damn it. But anyway, that, like I said, it is a tangent, but we ought to go off to the rest of the show.
Right now, we just need more barnacles.
Because Donna's invention for making dentures, basically, is going to need more barnacles, Jonah and Nicole offer to just go out and harvest some in the bay.
Hey, we can collect those.
Yeah, the pilings at the harbor are just loaded with them.
Okay, if we use the outboard?
Sure, go ahead.
Another interesting parallel to the future here, when Abraxane was being developed, Patrick Soon-Shiong enlisted the help of a plucky brother-sister team to procure the pig embryos he needed to test with. Sorry, enough about the billionaire, let's move on.
Hey, make sure the life jackets are on your back.
So let's cut back to Margolin. He's still trying to feed fish to the dog, Ralph.
Maybe you've been too long without good red meat. Is that it? All right, man. If I can find it, red meat it is, then.
He heads off and leaves the dog alone. You might see where this is going. The moment he leaves, Joan and Nicole are puttering in towards the dog, collecting barnacles under a pier as they go along. The dog stares at them ominously and starts growling, and we see a very stock horror movie POV shot as the dog spies the kids unseen, and finally, the dog leaves the boat. He's crawling towards them as he balances on the horizontal beams of the pier, which is, I mean, kudos to training a dog to do that. And nice, innocent Nicole sees the dog, goes like, oh, hey, boy, what's going on? Reaches towards the dog, and in a bit of quick editing,
it's a dog! He bit me! He bit me!
Dog just snap, bites her hand. Now, that's a puncture wound. And of course, what you do in a show like this, if you're worried about how much the censors will come down on you, you immediately get a handkerchief covering up the supposed wound. The actor holds their hand in it and acts out the pain. And depending on how daring you are, you put a few drips of fake blood on the handkerchief. And, you know, kudos, this show doesn't really do that. You don't see the actual puncture, but they have no reservations about just covering this child actress's hand in fake blood. She's just, like, holding on to her hand, and they've just already got a bunch of wonderful spaghetti sauce just all over her hands.
Jonah, it really hurts.
So Ocean Hellman is holding onto her hand, going, ooh, ow, this really hurts, oh god. You know, the usual routine. And then Jonah just immediately goes,
I gotta check the dog, see if he's...
What?
He could have rabies, Nicole.
Oh no.
Just stay put.
Hold on, I'm gonna check on that dog. It might have rabies. Which, you know, I don't know, it's possible. It definitely sounds like something that could happen in a rare circumstance. And I mean, these characters do have some sort of a preternatural understanding of what the plot of these episodes are going to be. But, I mean, you get bit by a dog and somebody else immediately goes, oh, let me check for rabies. I mean, that's something that you do if you're trying to fuck with somebody. If you're being a little sadistic little shit, that's what you would do too. So Jonah, you know, runs over, tries to get towards the dog. He's trying to confront Ralph or to check for, I don't know, foam at the mouth, I guess. And he just can't get close. You know, the dog is more agile, despite apparently having rabies. It can do its acrobatics underneath this pier a lot easier, I suppose.
Jonah, be careful!
Ralph!
Don't let him bite you!
And, you know, he can't get close. Something I can't help but notice here is they're playing scary growls in ADR over the soundtrack, but it really does just look like the dog is smiling the whole time.
I heard something.
I didn't hear anything.
You hear that?
Yeah.
Dog is just having the time of his life. He's going, I get to be on television. There's all these nice people feeding me treats, and all I gotta do is walk around and pretend to bite people. That's great. This dog is having the time of his life, despite supposedly trying to play a rabid dog.
What is it? Ralph!
So Ralph the dog just runs off. He finds his way back into Stuart Margolin's boat, who immediately knows something is off.
You bit a child. What's wrong with you? You never bit a person in your life. You're that out of sorts. Did they bother you?
Scared, but doesn't know exactly what's going on. Immediately after this, he is quickly confronted by a very military-looking dock guard.
You there! What are you doing here?
Good morning to you, Captain.
Answer the question, please. May I see your landing papers?
Then he asks about whether or not the dog is clear to leave the boat.
Well, has he been off your boat?
Not an inch.
You're just plain lucky. I want you out of here right away.
Ralph and me, we don't want to cause any problems. I'll be right out of here, right this minute.
So now it's basically revealed, even though Stuart Margolin's character really does look poacherish, this is one of the scant non-poacher episodes we've encountered right now. Instead, it's all about wildlife customs enforcement, basically. We finally have an episode dedicated to the brave men and women keeping people's dogs and cats out of Australia under the threat of euthanasia. It's about high time that they got a little bit of attention. Margolin just lies that Ralph never left the boat, and the cop angrily sends him off, and Margolin makes a clean getaway, and the dog doesn't ever get tested. It's kind of a funny thing. Like, we basically have shown that Margolin is basically boat hobo. He is assumed to be basically a Dust Bowl guy. We have confirmation that this character is homeless apart from his boat.
All Ralph and I got is the boat and the Lord's waters to sail on.
This is basically a guy with a waterproof bindle. We cut back to the lab and Nicole is getting that wound cleaned, and Jonah reveals he didn't really see any evidence of rabies. Granted, all he's looking for is a foaming mouth.
He was acting real crazy, but I couldn't make out any frothing at the mouth.
That only happens in the last and most violent stages. You took a dangerous chance, son.
Yeah, I know.
but I was worried about Nicole.
Grant maintains the possibility that it could be rabies.
That's a possibility we can't afford to overlook.
But Jonah really does seem to be fucking with Nicole this entire time. I don't think that it's even intentional. Jonah just brings up unprompted,
do they still treat people with all those shots in the stomach?
What? Dad, I can't go through that.
Take it easy. They don't do that anymore.
Exactly the worst thing that a little girl could hear at this moment. Michele tells us that they stopped doing that a few years ago. And I'm just going like, oh, how much we have progressed over the years. We just put rabies shots in the arm now. We don't have to jab it into the gut.
They stopped using the Pasteur treatment a few years ago. Now the rabies deployed vaccine is standard. They also give a rabies immunoglobulin shot with it to protect until the deployed
11.
Vaccine.
11.5 billion. Grant going into director mode. He wants that vaccine administered within 24 hours.
Chances are you won't even need it. We'll go find that dog, check him out. If he's healthy, that'll be the end of that. I want you to go and call the health department's weekend number and check to see where we can get that diploid cell vaccine in case we need it. I want her to have both those shots in 24 hours, and in half that time, if the dog is rabid.
I'll take care of it.
Thanks. Okay.
The city hospitals have access to something like that, but then there is a beautiful, like truly amazing plot contrivance here.
This just isn't our day. There's no more diploid vaccine. 8 people of an African expedition needed rabies shots last week, and the health department ordered more, but it won't be in until next week. They've got the globulin vaccine, though.
I want it right away.
An entire African expedition got rabies, which makes the health department entirely out of that specific vaccine. Like, how does that even come about? I mean, I guess you can have an issue of contamination or of something that is, you know, infected that everybody uses. But I mean, you hear, oh, an entire expedition got rabies, and you just go, what are these people passing around a hyena getting bitten for fun?
Oh, good Lord, you've got the rabies.
Visually, the most important thing to me about this scene is that George Dunbar's, Hagen Beggs's office has this giant massive window which is attached to the orca tank. Now, this is actually real. They didn't just set up a regular office set inside the viewing part of the orca tank and then just go to town with that. Lots of offices in the Vancouver Aquarium are directly attached to the orca tank, and they can look out their windows and just see orcas, or now the dolphins, just going around their business. And I mean, I remember visiting the aquarium as a kid and finding it really weird that the office windows were attached to the home of a massive, majestic sea creature, and every single one of them had their blinds closed. Some of it stemmed from not wanting tourists to spy on them, but it primarily came from an incident where the orca Hayak 2, through a complex system of clicks and bodily gestures, communicated to management that one of the employees was watching porn at work, and he was promptly fired. So that's why everybody has their blinds closed, really.
What'll happen to the dog if he is rabid?
He'll have to be killed immediately, and then the brain tissue examined to verify the rabies.
Do they really have to do that?
Well, unfortunately, there is no cure for animals. One rabid dog could start an epidemic in other animals and endanger a whole lot of people.
Grant gets in touch with that dock captain that we saw, and it turns out that he's working a small military dock in Vanier Park, which is actually still there. So I was saying that he looked really military, and then it turned out he wasn't just overdressed for the occasion. This guy actually works for the Navy, basically. And he identifies the boat, he tells Grant what he's looking for, and who's in it, and what he thought of the dog.
No idea, Doc. He just seemed like another wharf rat. But the dog seemed okay when I sent him all packing.
Well, which direction did they take?
Northwest.
Can you describe the boat?
Well, it was a black metal ketch. Nothing very special about it.
And then Grant, who we've already seen is in charge of the cops, or at least outranks them, talks to the guy in the military garb and goes,
can you help us with this helicopter hovercraft?
Look, can you get us a hovercraft? Which is amazing. It's beautiful. Now, it is clear that the Vancouver Aquarium is able to tell the regular police what to do. But it is a debate among fans still to this day exactly what level of control that the Vancouver Aquarium has over the Canadian military or the Navy. The usual theory that people have about this scene is that it is to demonstrate that actually, you know, maybe the control the aquarium has over the military is limited, but in this instance, Grant probably outranks this dock captain. The chain of command between the Vancouver Aquarium and the Canadian Navy is probably a complex system of checks and balances.
Can you help us with this helicopter hovercraft?
Look, don't worry. I'll get on it right away. It might take a little while.
Thanks, Bill. You know how important this is.
I do.
Grant gets on his Vancouver Aquarium branded boat, shoves off, and gives chase. He brings Jonah along with him, and I guess that can make sense story-wise, but he also brings Nicole on, which, you know, why would he bring Nicole around if she's A, injured, and B, potentially rabid, potentially gonna get the stirs, gonna go on this boat chase and go, oh no, Nicole, your pelt is so matted all of a sudden. What happened to your lustrous fur? Grant needs an extra set of eyes, and so he asks for backup. The person that he asks for backup, again, is Joyce. Grant is asking for backup from Joyce, and it's the same thing as the last episode. Grant will pursue on the ground, or I suppose on the sea, and then Joyce will get a better view from above. This is a pretty common dynamic that happens in a lot of the action scenes in this show. The discussion on the radio is actually filmed kind of dynamically. It's really interesting, at least for a TV show of this era and of this, at this point, little renown just yet. She's talking on the radio while the plane moves towards the camera and the mechanic is doing a bunch of maintenance, and the movement is really smooth. It's just this smooth transition to her moving into the cockpit from the radio to talking to the mechanic to getting into the plane and then just flying off. And it's very few cuts, surprisingly. It's pretty well put together. The next bit to me is kind of an uncanny sight. Joyce is just going to fly away, and the crew is going to take advantage of that access to a pontoon plane and show a lot of views of urban scenes of Vancouver before the plane moves out into a more wild area. And as the plane flies out, they deliberately choose to put the plane with a backdrop of Canada Place still under construction. Now, Canada Place is, as a building, only sort of architecturally interesting. It juts straight out into the water like you built a pier and then you decided to turn it into a totally enclosed building. It's got a big tent that raises and descends, sort of like canopies on sports stadiums. I mean, for the most part, it's just a convention center. Hell, it's a convention center that now has to compete with another, even more architecturally impressive one built right next to it. And by that, I mean, it juts out exactly the same as Canada Place, but it has a green roof.
It's really too big to think about simply as a building.
The green roof, the glass, the exterior glass wall, the wood walls, they're all very unique to this project.
What's more interesting to me is what this building represents. When you talk about Vancouver architecture downtown, it often goes, well, we've got a whole swath of modern buildings coming from as late as 1986, but we also have some real great bits of vintage architecture coming from as far back as 1986. And Canada Place is effectively that harbinger. It's a centerpiece of the great change to Vancouver that occurred in Expo 86. We're right on the cusp of the old city, the old Vancouver, being washed away. This building, especially under construction, evokes such a specific era to the extent that it feels like it'd be heavy-handed visual exposition in a period piece. Like, if an American movie showed the Empire State Building being built, or a Japanese movie showed the Tokyo Olympic Stadium being halfway up, or in a more tasteless category, when a movie uses CGI to put the Twin Towers back up onto the skyline. But I mean, the thing is, this shot of Canada Place under construction is contemporary for its time. It's trying to be modern, it's trying to show what Vancouver looks like at that time, but it's accidentally so of its era that it becomes a period piece in a way that seems unintentional, but inadvertently artificial as well.
I mean, any kid today, though, would still be impressed by the McBarge and getting fries on a ship.
We cut back to Stuart Margolin and his dog, and mostly we are demonstrating that the dog is getting slowly nuttier over the last few hours. He does not know what the hell is going on anymore.
What is it? Growl.
Even on what is effectively a long-distance boat chase, Grant still keeps calling work and keeps on asking his boss about those vaccines. And as they keep doing this, there's more and more contrivances just piling on top of each other. I mean, nothing's going to beat there was an African expedition and every single person got rabies. But they start going, oh no, it's all the labs on the East Coast are closed for the weekend.
Nicole can have the globulin shots tonight just to be safe.
But we need the diploid ready.
If it has to come from the East Coast, there's plenty of time to get it on a plane.
I know. But I've already checked.
The 3-hour time difference, all the labs are
closed down for the weekend.
Try the hospitals.
Right. I'm keeping on it.
Thanks, George.
I mean, that, tell me that that doesn't happen. In Canada, I feel like Canadians have to deal with the time difference more than other people for some reason, just because so much stuff is in Ontario and in Quebec, and I live on the opposite coast. Now, this next thing is pure nitpickery, and I totally confess to that, but one little thing that is kind of weird is when you film in Vancouver and you're trying to explicitly showcase, you know, the Vancouver landscape, you're probably going to do a bunch of stuff that doesn't make sense logistically just so that you can get the good shots. Grant and his family in the previous scene, they had exited just past the Burrard Bridge, and then in this scene, they're passing under the Lionsgate Bridge, which basically means they went west a few kilometers and then just went back east the moment the coast opened up again. Like, this is in a boat probably 15 minutes. You can ride your bicycle and you can get from this bridge at the start to the next bridge in like 20, maybe 30 minutes if you're fast. It's like a walkable distance. Then in the next aerial shot, we see them going in the opposite direction under the bridge. So it is purely just, well, what is the most beautiful bits of Vancouver? And we will rearrange logistically around that. And I mean, it is understandable that they would do this because the shot is of Joyce in her plane flying right past the Lionsgate Bridge. And the Lionsgate Bridge, which sort of connects West Van, which is technically a different city, to Vancouver proper. And it is basically one of the main things that you see on postcards here. And you can understand why it is a big tourist thing, because it goes straight into Stanley Park. And that means that you've got this image of this big 1930s looking bridge that is huge and a nice bright green, and it's going straight into a forest, basically. Like, it disappears into the woods, and it's a great visual. So lots of people do use Lionsgate Bridge as part of their commute. The traffic is bad, but it looks really good. The thing that does it for me, though, that is a little, one of the reasons that I don't ride my bicycle over it, is that there is a water treatment plant directly underneath. So that means that it is very beautiful and it's good for photos. And if you're driving, it's a really nice commute. But if you are not insulated from the smell of feces on a foggy day, it becomes slightly less pleasant. But I mean, that is most of Vancouver life, I suppose. Things are very beautiful to look at, and they are good to behold if you have the insulation of a car or of your own house. But if you are unprotected, the awful smell of everything around you starts to become overpowering. Joyce gets on the radio and just starts talking to Nicole over the walkie-talkie. And a lot of the stuff she's saying is supposed to be encouraging, but it's obvious that everything that she's saying is just reminding Nicole about her rabies. No matter how much you say about how you're going to get past it, I mean, if you keep on saying, yeah, Nicole, don't worry about the rabies that you have.
How are you doing?
I'm okay, I guess.
The rabies that you have isn't going to be that big of an issue. We will probably find a cure for your rabies that are racing through your bloodstream right now.
Hang in there, come on.
I mean, even if the rabies makes you start foaming in your mouth and your vision starts getting permanently wrecked, we will fix this issue of the rabies that are slowly making their way into your nervous system. Don't think about the rabies, Nicole. We've got it. We've got your rabies under control. Don't think about the rabies.
With all these people on your side, what could go wrong, right?
Right.
And so after the pep talk, Nicole, you know, maybe it's an acting issue. Maybe Nicole didn't get, maybe Ocean Hellman didn't get directed in the right way, but she looks way more depressed after that pep talk than she did before. I wouldn't blame her. There are lots of pep talks in the world that just make you feel worse.
Right.
Oh Lord, you've got the rabies.
Remember Grant asking the military guy if he can get access to a hovercraft? Well, it turns out that that worked.
Grant, have you heard from the Coast Guard?
Yeah, Joyce.
They're standing in a hovercraft as soon as they get clearance. Keep looking.
Just like telling the Coast Guard to just speed up, that just worked. Now we've got footage of a hovercraft going around looking for a little boat with a dog in it.
Roger, North Star. This is Neptune.
I'm departing Comox. ETA, your position, 6 minutes.
Thank you, Neptune.
Grant really does have that control. He can just get all the cool weaponry, all the cool utility that he wants, and it will just do his bidding. It is a great power fantasy if you work at an aquarium. The camera turns back on Margolin, and the inevitable has happened. Ralph the dog is getting really mad, getting really agitated, and Margolin tries to grab at the dog, and he himself finally gets bit.
You want to tell me what it is, don't you?
I know, I know. As soon as we put in...
Ralph!
Oh! Good Lord, you've got the rabies!
Great line reading. Between now and 10 minutes ago, apparently, I mean, we were just told that foaming at the mouth is the final stage of rabies. And I mean, I don't know how fast rabies develops in the nervous system or, you know, in the bloodstream of a mammal. But the fact that we are going from no signs of foaming at the mouth to like pure foaming at the mouth, just a whole bunch of shaving cream on its face that fast is, well, I mean, what do we expect, some sort of magic xylophone here? What do we expect, some magic rabies in this dog? But it is a plot hole. Let's just call it, is a plot hole. Though, I mean, really, the bigger inconsistency that's going on here is that, you know, this dog has foam put on its mouth, and we've got a bunch of scary growling over the ADR, but, I mean, this dog is way too happy for this to work. He's got his tongue out, he's got big blue eyes, he's panting like somebody has just shaken his favorite toy at him. just off camera. In some ways, it does make what's going on a little sadder, because it's not quite an old Yeller thing. It makes us sadder because we're being made to envision the diseased death of a dog that everyone watching can see, in reality, has nothing wrong with them. Like, they're going, like, the show is going, oh man, it's gonna suck when this dog dies. Look at how great this dog is, even as we are putting all these fakey little indicators that he's supposed to be diseased.
He'll have to be killed immediately.
Mostly you're just going, look at this cute dog. It's gonna suck when we kill him. Get ready for it.
Killed immediately.
The search continues, and Grant and Joyce start doing a lot of name drops of Vancouver geography.
Doc, we found nothing around Ragged Island.
Bear east and check out the cove.
We'll continue searching the Bowen Island area.
Have checked north from Gibson's to Powell River.
It's basically like when American shows just start listing off a bunch of Californian highways. It's sort of like that. One little thing, I don't know exactly how they managed to leap from Lionsgate Bridge to Bowen Island so quick when the last time we had this big cut, going from the Burrard Bridge to Lionsgate Bridge was a big trek, basically. Back on the boat, Margolin watches Ralph barking in the ship's hold, and Margolin looks back and forth. He's totally conflicted, and then with a little bit of hemming and hawing, he finally just accepts, yep, it's old Yeller time. He opens a steel box and he pulls out his rifle. Now, I know rifles are sensitive things, especially if you're living near salt water, so you've got to protect them in some way, but there is something so disconcerting to me about the image of a gun covered in a dirty potato sack. Margolin loads the gun with his bloodied hand. He walks into the hold. Wide shot of the boat and nothing else, and next thing we see after an ad break, Margolin leaves the ship's hold. He's got a bag with his dead dog in it, and he's obviously totally choked up about it.
How you be dressed, Ralph?
And it's a sad scene, but I mean, there's something unintentionally funny to me about how excessively bloody this potato sack is. What, did you miss the first time? Like, how many bullets did you put in this dog? This thing is seeping with blood. Margolin carries the bag, and he does what he can with the emotional weight of having to mime a weight of a bloody bag of old newspapers, basically. Puts it down, and finally Margolin resolves to report the rabies.
Now, we better go find that poor girl, shouldn't we, Ralph?
And signals with the sail of his boat to Joyce at long last. Joyce happens to fly over. Margolin just assumes, oh yeah, they're coming for me. Makes a signal with his sail and gets ready to get picked up. Turns out that that hovercraft was just totally extraneous.
Neptune, this is North Star. We've located the boat up in Half Moon Bay. That's wonderful news. Roger, returning to base. Neptune out.
I'm guessing Paul Saltzman either had the footage or wanted to use it. And I mean, who can blame him? Hovercrafts are cool. Really, the important part for us to know in this show, lore-wise, don't forget that Grant has this authority. He can tell the Coast Guard what they can do, and now he's managed to be able to tell a guy in military garb to his face, I want you to commission this hovercraft. I mean, that's what's really important in the long run for this show. There's a shot that's actually kind of strikingly lonely of Margolin looking off, standing on the roof of his boat, waiting for the aquarium people to arrive. It's just him back to the camera, looking off at the rocky landscape. And it's actually, to me, there's all these grand vistas that they're showing in this show, all these views straight out from the cockpit of a plane, showing all the big tourist areas. But really, this is the shot to me that makes me think about Vancouver the most. This rocky, sort of uncaring landscape, a sort of beautiful desolation with a little bit more water and trees. Margolin and the robber's family finally get to meet, and they talk with each other.
You're looking for my dog, I know. There he is there.
Killed immediately.
Pointing at a bag just totally soaked in blood, Margolin sort of explains what was going on and what was going on in his head and gives this grand apology for all the troubles that he's caused. And something that is striking about this episode, nobody gets excessively mad at Stuart Margolin about all this. And I mean, in terms of writing a script, it would have been very easy.
The thought never came to me until he bit my hand. I just came back to find the girl. It was you, wasn't it, my girl?
Yes.
I'm so sorry. You see, Ralph there, he was the sweetest, gentlest friend a man could want. How could such a thing happen?
But instead, the plot just immediately prioritizes Nicole's fear and the need to get the right vaccine for her, and now for Margolin as well.
Now, don't worry, sweetheart. They'll have the globulin vaccine when we get home, and everything will be okay.
Really, the only criticism he gets that he didn't give his dog the proper shots is practically ADR'd in.
How could such a thing happen?
Well, I'm afraid you let it happen. Your dog should have had his shots.
For both of the episodes that we've seen about poachers, I think I said that the opportunity for redemption or forgiveness is foreclosed upon before we even meet any of the characters. But here, this character is just forgiven just right off the bat. It's a very different way of thinking about these characters. Grant gives Stuart Margolin all of these directives for what he's supposed to do about everything that is potentially infected with rabies in his boat.
Well, Mr. Perry, you can tie your boat up at my dock until you and my daughter have had your rabies shots. But we're going to have to burn everything that your dog could have salivated on, and then we're going to have to scrub your boat down thoroughly with a disinfectant.
Whatever you say. Trouble after cause.
As I listen to the dialogue, I basically go, man, the way the world has changed, huh? You can't even get somebody to get basic vaccinations nowadays. And Margolin, a man who very clearly has very little in his possession, gets told, burn everything your dog might have salivated on. And he just accepts that willingly. Now, I mean, not to stereotype, but if you were trying to create a visual portrait of anti-vaxxer on an episode of, I don't know, Law and Order, you couldn't really do much better than Margolin right now and how he looks. But we're not in that world just yet. So we can actually give this character a little bit of benefit of the doubt.
Whatever you say.
As the boat gets towed away, we hear from the aquarium staff that they still haven't found the right vaccine that they need. They do have a vaccine that'll keep these symptoms at bay, but nothing yet that will actually get the rabies out of their system.
Donna says they still haven't been able to locate the second vaccine.
Dad. Now don't worry, sweetheart, don't worry. There's still plenty of time.
Fast forward a few hours, we've got the dog on a surgery table in the aquarium lab, and they start going through all of the symptoms of rabies that this dog has. Donna, in a very interesting line read, just goes,
Grant, I have a positive ID in everybody's. He was loaded with rabies.
He was loaded with rabies. And that's, loaded with rabies is just such a funny turn of phrase for me. Just that sort of choice. Going like, oh yeah, that dude's stomach, loaded with cancer. This guy's kidney, loaded with stones. Just using the phrase loaded in any way in regards to a medical issue is funny to me for some reason. Another weird turn of phrase from billionaire Donna.
Will you file the report?
Sure. Grant, don't let this make you crazy.
I'll be with George.
Don't let this make you crazy. It's not the most sensitive thing to say in regard to rabies. More searching for the right vaccine. Grant and Hagen Beggs are talking about how fast they gotta work, where they gotta look for the proper vaccine that they need, etc. They're doing the big walk and talk.
Donna's gonna let me know the minute she locates the vaccine.
Well, Nicole has to have it right away.
Well, we're still trying the hospitals.
And it's a bit of a mixed visual message because they're doing all of this through the rainforest wing of the aquarium, which just so happens to be where they keep the sloths. It's been a busy day for everybody in the Roberts household, and Nicole has to be sent off to bed. And strangely enough, though, in order to give more educational input to the people who are watching the show, Nicole decides to go on the computer and learn everything about the rabies that are inside her right before she goes to bed. You know, as you do.
Rabies, also known as hydrophobia, an acute deadly virus disease transmitted by the bite of an infected animal. Fatal to humans. Treatment should be started immediately following exposure.
Your arm still sore?
Not much.
Hey, do you want some hot chocolate too?
She's going to bed, and the last thing that she's thinking about before she closes her eyes is the deadly disease circulating in her body right now. You know, you go to bed and you start, you know, reading about anemia, and I gotta tell you, just visions of sugar plums dancing in one's head. Now here's the thing. After Nicole goes to bed thinking about her rabies, there is, like, no time left in this 22-minute episode. I mean, I guess they didn't realize how much time was left. They did all this filming and they had all these shots that they didn't want to get rid of, apparently. Like, the script literally has the proper vaccine, like, phoned in. Like, literally, it's a phone call.
That could be George. Don't go just yet.
Hagenbeggs calls in and goes, oops, I found a lab in Toronto that can get it in by 9 a.m. tomorrow.
I've caused a lot of sleepless nights in North America, but I think the job is done. I got the manager in a lab outside Toronto to open up.
He's sending the vaccine.
Grant is too much of a dad to give thanks beyond simply saying,
George.
Yes?
Thanks very much.
Oh, forget it.
And, yeah, that's it. There's an ad break, but there's very little to actually do. The plane flies in.
Here it is.
Thanks, Joyce.
We see a nurse administer a shot to Nicole.
Okay, dear, now let's have that arm.
Are there any side effects?
No, dear, it just eliminates the rabies.
We sort of pan away so we don't see the needle entering her arm. And, you know, hey, we're done. Episode's done.
Well, I'll be leaving now.
Okay, well, I'll walk you down.
We finish the whole thing up with a quick discussion between Margolin and Grant. Him talking about the rough life that he's got.
I really thank you, folks. It's the closest thing to living with a family I can remember.
You're welcome.
And how he's feeling about rabies and all the trouble he's caused. And he's very sad and sorry about it. And then they go, well, you can go off and live your life. But there's one last thing we want to do. And they bring in a brand new dog.
Jonah and I didn't want you to get real lonely on that boat. So,
come on in, Donna.
Oh.
Surprise!
Surprise! Oh. What a fine-looking fella.
We were hoping that you would like him.
And I'm looking at it, and it is almost assuredly the same dog. They're holding him, like, really close together and holding him as if he's a baby, but he is the exact same size as Ralph the rabies dog.
And he's had all his rabies shots.
Good. Good.
And then they cut to Stuart Margolin going into the boat, floating off into the horizon. They freeze frame on everybody waving at him, and then that's the end of the episode.
How would it be if for now I was to call you Ralph, and then after you're all grown up, then it'll be Ralph, huh? Then after that, you and me will sail around the world together one last time.
It ends really fast. So, I mean, what do we have to think about for this episode? I mean, it's really nice to see Margolin do a little bit of acting. He is given some opportunities to be a good character actor. He's playing a very broad sort of type, but he is doing it fairly well. It is interesting to see this story have way more individualized stakes. They're high stakes, but we're not dealing with complex operations this time. It's not a poacher episode, even if it does involve technically breaking the law.
Answer the question, please. May I see your landing paper? Well, has he been off your boat?
And really, this is the first episode of this show in which some sort of modicum of mercy is given to people who skirt the rules to some extent. You know, when you watch those first two episodes, you can sort of expect, like, there is a universe in which Stuart Margolin just goes like, I don't care. I love having a dog with rabies. It makes my dog really cool. It makes my dog get that killer instinct. And I love having a dog with rabies. And you can't stop me. Ha ha ha. And then he gets punched. He falls into the water. And then end of episode. But we did something a little nicer this time, and it's really the first main episode that we've had that deals with forgiveness rather than Grant being a instrument of divine aquatic revenge. It's also good to see Nicole, who in the previous episode was mostly defiant when she got kidnapped.
Horses don't mind because they're not criminals.
We had some sort of scene of the Lisa Simpson of this show being a little more vulnerable and expressing some actual worry and trying to, you know, being given a bit more of an opportunity to show some acting chops than the previous episode. There was one main scene in the second episode that she did some good acting, but for the most part, it was an action show, and so she was off to the side. But now we actually get to see Ocean Hellman being an actress. As Stuart Margolin goes off into the sunset, literally, you know, riding off into the sunset and talking to his brand new dog, I just wanted to talk about this particular character that he's playing and his relationship to the outside world, basically. Now, I've talked about some of the aquatic fantasia that goes on in some of these episodes of Danger Bay, the school boat, remember? It could be assumed by this Depression-era chic that Margolin is wearing and the confirmation that he is homeless apart from his boat, like that this is another exaggeration to make Danger Bay's Vancouver seem more aquatically oriented than it actually is. This idea of like, oh, it's a boat hobo. You know, he's got a waterproof bindle and he's living off a smoked cod. He's living underneath the tracks of an underwater train. And this is a premise that you might expect to be a little bit of an exaggeration, and understandably so. But I've met people like this before. Every once in a while, I hang around cafes in Deep Cove, and because it has one of the few public marinas in the area, one rainy day, the only customers were me and a man who lived in his boat, and he was sheltering from the wind. Apparently, he'd been there since opening, and he was desperate to talk to anybody about anything, because he hadn't had the chance to, in a week, talk to anybody apart from enforcers, like the one in this episode, who were shuffling him off from place to place. There isn't really any sort of rambling journey like what's implied for Margolin going from place to place. You really only move when you're forced to. His boat, this guy would readily say, was basically the only thing keeping him from counting among the truly homeless, like sort of like people who their house is their car or their RV or something like that. The main things he wanted to talk about with me was everything that was wrong with the boat, all the repairs he couldn't really afford, the fact that he was getting tired of eating all the canned and all the dry food that he had. I sort of wonder how much of this life was voluntary and how much was involuntary at this point in his life. To be clear, I don't think this was some wealthy guy having the mother of all midlife crises and taking to the sea, though I'm sure people like that exist. Wealthy people don't have teeth like this guy had by choice. I don't know if this was the exact trajectory of his life, but I can easily imagine it, and imagine it happening to a lot of people in Vancouver specifically, especially considering his age. You come to Vancouver in maybe like the early 80s, and you can't afford a house because you're still looking for work. So hey, you're going to work on the water anyway. So buy a boat, think of it as an investment, and build up some money before you make your life on land with the established Vancouverites. But the more you work, the more jobs you swap between. By the time you make the money that was supposed to have done the job, the rules have changed. It's a service economy now. You don't have the money to even rent a place still. And the rent issue is so bad, in fact, that you can't even just dock the boat and live there. Industrial ports are full up, and civilian ports are expecting the average boat owner to be making dental practice money at a minimum. And they price those docks accordingly. The city has marooned you. It's an entirely different game after they built this new thing called Canada Place. And this guy I was talking to isn't an isolated case. You can go to the water around Science World and find little patches that look like Water World, really. Just a whole collection of boats and docks and buoys and anything that floats just tied together to try and make as much of a home for somebody as possible. That sort of life sort of seems like purgatory to me. There's a shore full of skyscrapers, but you're only permitted an island a meter or two wide that doesn't even have the benefit of standing still. As far as you're concerned, those glittering towers, the bustle of city life, it doesn't have a purpose beyond solely to mock you. And that's Vancouver. Developers implemented this thing called the SMART system, which stands for Smooth Movement Across Random Terrain. And the thing that was... So that was the end of that episode. Thanks for listening. Thanks for tuning in. I hope you enjoyed this episode. Just going to bring up this next new episode of Danger Bay today. Jonah Roberts slices his sonic glaive through the necks of three rabid dogs at once. The remnants of the bodies explode into red mist. A whole swarm of wild dogs have surrounded him. The camera spins 360 degrees around Jonah as each dog attacks him one by one like a kung fu film, all swiftly and lethally dispatched by the eons-old glaive. The CGI blood takes up 30% of the screen. Shit, Jonah contemplates to himself, snapping yet another husky's spine in half. I never should have listened to the pencil pushers at the aquarium's health response unit. Putting a chip in every fucking dog's brain for instant rabies detection was never a safe plan. All it's done is create a back door for the sea urchin god to hack through. Now he's got his spiky fingers into the neural functions of all the canines in the city. A snarling corgi leaps at Jonah, who promptly redirects its momentum straight through a plate glass window. Somebody is gonna have to pay for this incompetence, Jonah reflects, cutting through his third Australian cattle dog of the day. All these beautiful animals, sent to the slaughter by my own hand. I'd cry if I had any tears left to shed. Jonah pushes a few buttons on his wireless wrist radio, patching himself in to the neurally enhanced sea lion, which serves as an intermediary between the Vancouver Aquarium and the National Military. We need to raise all the kennels in the city, he yells. I'm officially ordering every Leopard 3 tank we have to blow up all of the kennels. Just that moment, an entire family of slobbering St. Bernards drop from the rafters, executing a stealth death-from-above maneuver. Jonah's ancient scythe erases the dog's entire bloodline in a single swing before any of them even manage to hit the ground. Jonah busts out a quip. It's going to take more than a bit of brandy to fix that. Motherfucker. A message pings on Jonah's heads-up display. It's from the head of the aquarium's health department, situated out on Bowen Island. Mr. Roberts, we found the source of the hack. It was localized at the access point in my house, sir. I know the aquarium is meant to centralize all its data in one place to prevent against extra-dimensional hacks, but I thought my home had all the appropriate protective sigils. Nobody could have predicted the sea urchin god would have come back. I can fix this. All I need to do is find a way to quarantine my home network, and I can still save many of the dogs. All I need is some time. Mr. Roberts, Jonah, I know this is my fault, but you have to understand, my daughter, she has the BKD. I needed that access to work on finding a cure. I was trying to save lives, but now, all the damage I've caused. Even though I know I don't deserve forgiveness, Mr. Roberts, there's nothing I can do but apologize. Jonah says nothing for a long time before finally speaking. If there's anyone who knows what BKD can do to a human body, it's me. Doctor, I forgive you. Get to work cutting off that hack immediately. I'll try to hold off these dogs on my end. Thank you, Mr. Roberts. I'll need an hour and a half tops. The health department head hangs up. The moment the call ends, Jonah immediately gets back in contact with the military sea lion. Change of plans. Call off the Leopard 3s. Instead, I want everybody to get in their planes and drop every fucking bomb you've got on the house of the traitorous motherfucker I was just talking to. The sea lion salutes with his flipper and ends the call. That ought to quarantine your little home network. Bitch. Cut to the nighttime silhouette of Bowen Island as explosion after fiery explosion lights up the horizon. A montage begins, showing waves of rabid, mind-controlled dogs falling unconscious as the malware controlling their brain chips shuts off from the west end to East Van. Jonah sharply exhales through his nose, the closest thing to a sigh of relief he'll ever produce. He's now smoking a Newport in his blood-stained right hand, watching the sunset on a new day in Vancouver. The camera slowly pans down to his left hand, revealing that he is clutching a massive key ring, holding tens, if not hundreds, of literal dog tags. Blood runs down his arm and past his hand, staining the dog tags an even deeper shade of red. Freeze frame as the credits roll. Really good episode. Great writing. I think it really demonstrates how modern Danger Bay better understands creating emotional stakes in your TV show. Like the old episode we went through this podcast, like I'm supposed to have all this emotional investment in one guy's dog with rabies. You know how you actually produce real emotional stakes? You have every dog in the entire city get rabies. Now that's how you get some actual investment out of your audience. Way better. Well, that's it for me today. Thanks very much again for listening. I hope we've all learned something today. I'm not sure exactly what. Check out the usual social feeds, Twitter, Blue Sky, etc. I'm Kasm Cave, K-A-S-M-K-A-V-E. One last little bit of self-promo. If you live in the Vancouver area and you're looking for a fun way to spend an hour or two outside, I've written two guided tours of Gastown and Granville Island, respectively, for a tourism app called Questo. Think of it as a mini phone-based ARG. Unfortunately, copyright laws being what they are, I'm not allowed to insert any Danger Bay stuff in it. The Gastown tour is for pay, but the Granville Island one is currently in a free beta. If you want to test it out and then send me some notes, then please let me know. Otherwise, just give it a try and leave a rating. Alright, see you later, guys. Danger comes from below.
Infinite Danger was written, recorded, and produced by Will Riley in association with KS Media LLC. The theme is derived from Amore Grande, Amore Profondo by Il Guardiano Dal Faro. We can be contacted through Twitter or Blue Sky at KASMKAVE or through kittysneezes.com. Danger Bay was produced by Danger Bay Productions Incorporated in association with the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation, Telefilm Canada, and the Disney Channel. This has been a Kitty Sneezes production. Thank you.
Danger. Danger.
Danger.
Danger hasn't come home yet.
Sneezes.com in color.